KSV was overly dominant and that they executed the level that we typically expect from them, at least in their performance yesterday, especially when I look at Sky Temple and the results that, or at least the play that they had on that. And this is a bold statement, I feel like, here. The fact that we're going to be going to both Skya Foundry, selected by KSV, map bans going on to Tomb and Cursed Hollow. And this is why this is so curious, is not only because both of these teams typically are going to prioritize banning over Braxis Holdout, but Korean region, we know that they like to rid of, you know, Braxis, rid of the Volskaya, rid of those maps that they typically don't want to hold their own on. And when we see region in Korea, when they avoid banning out that map, it's almost like an agreement to avoid picking them, right? Yeah. So the KSV is selecting this out the gates. To me, that screams scared.
That's the whole thing about Korea, is that there's this mutual respect. You and I actually had a conversation about that this morning, is the top teams within Korea generally like, look, I won't pick this map. If you won't pick this map, we'll keep it standard. Even the bans that they have against each other will sometimes change and be like, look, we know we're in a best of five. We'll go against these maps, and there's really not that much out of the ordinary. KSV Black has not played this battleground this phase yet. Tempest has. That was against Gluck, so a very different level of competition. That was also before the Protector changes. So this map, since those changes, is heavily favored around the team fights, around those control points. And with these two teams, that's pretty exciting to start the day.
I mean, we're going to see a lot of high-level fights basically around this protectorate, around the objective, the control point. This is a map, obviously, we've seen only one time in Korea, I think, which is actually the map you just referenced with Tempest. And it's a map where we've seen crazy bans in Korea because the changes have not been implemented in HTC Korea, like the Nazebo ban, for example. So this is going to be a learning experience for everyone around the world as to how Koreans will play this map, just simply because it hasn't been done yet. So we're going to jump right into the ban here. It will be blue team of the first ban. That means Team Tempest, as this was KSV Black's map choice.
One thing that is going to stand out for me is the hero pools. Obviously, we've seen kind of a lot of favoritism towards the Junkrat on the side of KSV, but then you look over at somebody like Lockdown. He's played four heroes, Dreadnought, so far. Tempest has the smallest hero pool, I believe, of any team in the world at 26 total heroes played. But why change it up, right? If you're dominating people that hard, why change it up? And so the Genji right now, four games played for Dami. But when you look at Lockdown, it's a lot of Hanzo, Falstad, Jaina, and Li Ming. Now, those heroes don't necessarily stand out on this battleground anymore.
I agree with you, especially because we're looking at that, you know, post-protector changes and the adjustments there. KSV sticking to a very standard 1-2 for them in the second road, or in this second pick slot, going with the Malfurion and the Tracer provides a lot of threat. Right now, neither team really committing in too major heavy of a direction. I will say Tempest going with the Tyrael ban, it's not like that's a weird ban, but it is a little bit different than what we've seen kind of forming as the Eastern Clash meta. And I hope to see them, you know, kind of capitalize on that lack of sanctification opportunity. Or, you know, it makes me wonder, is there going to be a different prioritization of Blaze? Because that counter momentum is obviously something they're considering.
I think the Blaze is the go-to here for Tempest, especially against the Tracer. It's considered somewhat of a counter to Pulse Bomb, obviously, in some of these team fights. Also, Tyrael can be a great supplement for Tracer, especially in these longer fights that will happen around the control points, because you have that shield so often. His level one that was buffed with his rework is just so powerful with a hero like Tracer that's such a small health pool. And it's a pretty reasonable ban. What they go with the Blaze, or what they grab with the Blaze, is a big question. They're actually going to leave the Blaze open here. They're going to go to the Junkrat. And this is a smart choice because it's been a go-to pick for Black. We have seen Junkrat rising up in popularity across China and Korea throughout this event. And they're going to match sustained healing for sustained healing with this Stukov pick. The only weakness of the Stukov here, though, is it does not empower Dragon Blades for Genji.
Well, the Junkrat pickup, I think, here is probably the most telling. It gives you that sustain. It gives you the wave clear in case you need to go split off to soak a lane. But the Stukov also stands out to me. In 19 of the 23 games, we had Uther Rhaegar for Hyde, and he was who you were talking about being the standout. Rhaegar does not do well normally against Tracer, doesn't have the same level of protection. Uther does well to give that armor and to empower the Genji, but in terms of sustain on Volskaya, very different. That's where Stukov comes in. So I was really curious about the support pickup. That's already answered, and the fact that Junkrat was taken away from potentially going over their Black is also interesting. But guys, I have a question here before we get any deeper, because Tracer, you guys remember who the old Tracer player is here on KSV?
Kyocha, that's right.
Yeah. And now Kyocha is no longer on support role. Do they flex it up here?
I think they will put Kyocha on the Tracer in this case. We'll see what the draft becomes, because that'll be a little bit more telling, especially if it's a Melee Flex hero they choose that Rich is specialized in. For example, the Blaze that we've seen him play throughout HGC Korea this season, or something like a Dahaka or a Sonya, one of his more comfort picks, then it makes sense for Tracer to be played by Kyocha. If it's a more passive, like a Arthas or something like that, they end up going with at the end of the day, which I don't think is really going to be likely given the opponent's composition here. There's a chance that it ends up being played by DPS instead. With Sokka, of course, you know, sticking with the Malfurion, and he won't be flexing in this case.
It should be noted that this is the second time we've seen kind of a, I don't want to use the word spontaneous, but a bit of out of the norms Aerotal ban in the second rotation from a Korean team. And in both times, it's been paired with a Tracer on the top half of the draft. And so I can't help but feel like that gave a little bit of information on the mentality that they're going to have, because we originally kind of downplayed that into KSV being confident within their drafting and just going, we're going to remove objectively difficult the team fight into heroes. But now seeing this coming out from Tempest, and again, the dominance that they have had even over teams like KSV, it's something that maybe is going to indicate, you know, for these other teams that be a better hand at taking out some of the Korean teams and seeing their mentality in that.
This still isn't quite confirmation that we will see Kyocha on the Tracer just yet. It would make sense that they could put Falstad for reset, and then whatever the fifth pick ends up being for Rich is still a strong possibility. This isn't evidence enough just yet. Janna pick is really interesting to me, given that it's not a standout pick against Genji or Junkrat in terms of the blind synergy. So kind of an odd one here. Johanna has the ability to walk through silences with Stukov using her Iron Skin, and obviously can maybe try to bait out some of Junkrat's Concussive Minds if timed correctly, but kind of an unusual pick and not a high priority pick in Korea whatsoever. Very low priority in terms of main tank.
The Johanna in particular obviously is going to be a key point. We see the Mouth Ale in the ETC, so the Mouth Ale will help deal with that front side. Johanna does have that. The Tassadar pickup, a bit surprising.
Wow.
So now we've got the tell, right? So Falstad, Tracer, that's what I was saying. Like, the fact that we have Kyocha now moving back to that melee role, he's no longer on support, but Kyocha used to be the ultimate flex player. Now we've got Tassadar there. Falstad, you go back to BlizzCon, was played by Rich, but Falstad also has been played by Reset this year. And so Kyocha, the old Tracer player, but Rich can literally play any
let's,
of those heroes.
That,
so
this is not to forget that Kyocha's played a lot of Falstad in his career
yes,
as well.
Yeah. Literally everybody.
So the weird thing about this draft in general is that it just simply lacks a traditional solo laner. And what that means is that Falstad will likely be the solo laner, right, for the majority of the game in the offlane. There's going to be a lot of roaming, which I think goes back to that Zeratul pick. Perhaps they were worried it was going to be a roaming, marauding comp. Here are the predictions of the casters. I think we're all unanimously thinking that Tempest has had a better performance this tournament. However, after watching this draft, do you feel like maybe game one goes the other way?
I don't feel that way. I still feel pretty confident with it. I feel like KSV, I mean, I look at their composition and I just go, what year is it? It feels so dated, right? Yeah. It's not bad. It's just the cookie-cutter composition that fell out for a reason. A lot of those heroes and the intricacies of the strengths that they had at that point in time relative to the rest of the comps were just that much better, but that is anything but the case right now. It's just it's a little concerning to see a Volskaya come out that early from KSV, and normally they are not the team to flex up map picks. I feel like Tempest has got to be pretty comfortable.
Yeah, I think this draft is going to really struggle to really have an identity. It's not really a pick comp. It's not really a macro comp. But guys, it looks like game number one is ready. So take it away, casters, as we head into Volskaya.
Well, Dreadnought, we have ourselves a KSV.
There's a
versus.
There we go. Now we got a game. I was like, yeah, I think there's in fact a video game happening here. Volskaya Foundry. We talked about some of the uniqueness in the fact that we do have these two Korean teams selecting it. It's, again, only been played one time within the region out of all of HDC 2018 so far. Man, I mean, what about you, J-Hao? When you look at the comp like on both sides, like breaking it down a little bit more, do you feel, I mean, that KSV, they have a secret strategy going into it? My first thought was like, we know that Falstad used to be old school when you didn't go auto attack build and it was more Q stacking. Actually, it's a great synergy with Johanna. A condemn into a huge Q can just dominate. But look, it's still sees him in Markman, so that obviously is not the mentality here.
Yeah, I think maybe it's to just try and deal with that frontline control, because overall, Johanna does good to stand there, but she doesn't do much to control that. She doesn't do much to push them away to get that that big type of CC. So Falstad is kind of that hero because Tassadar is going to be up there. He's going to be peppering. Tracer will be flanking off. I think Falstad is there just to kind of give some threat at all to the front line just strictly through auto attacks. I think hitting those Q shots can sometimes be difficult. I think this would be the map for it because it's full sky. And as you said, using the Condemn there, especially against this composition, very melee heavy on the side of Tempest, would have liked to potentially seen that.
And right now, KSV is kind of trying to abuse the fact that they have pretty good wave clear, and then they're prioritizing flexing towards the top half and using the 1-4 split, and Tempest doing the inverse on the opposite side of the map. Both of the offlaners are obviously very susceptible, but this is actually KSV was the one dictating the rotations of this. Because of that wave clear advantage and putting the Falstad down to the bottom lane, they set themselves up to go at pretty much when you know you're going to lose the 1-4 effectively, but your 4-man has dominant wave clear, you can match them on the opposite sides and never have to deal with that, will my Falstad die? Because Tempest rotations now have to be so predictable that Falstad is not going to be in a poor position and show some of the concerns we normally have with the pick.
Yeah, the gameplay changes, I think, make that a little bit easier because you don't have to worry about depleting yourself of the ammo, things like that. That's why you see the Falstad so far back. So we'll see how he goes. Obviously, his wave clear doesn't come online until level 7, so he just is basically going to sit down there, chill, and really not step out at all.
It's just pretty much the game plan here is don't die for the Falstad. It feels like oftentimes that seems the game plan for the Falstad outside of the team fight situation here. Other than that, though, there doesn't seem to be too heavy of a tell in any one direction on how these teams are going to try and approach the team fight or the macro sense of the game. I mean, both teams backing out looking for a camp, but this is essentially standard, I feel like, at this point, not only just for Falstad, but all of competitive heroes since these changes in the mercenaries getting a bit earlier.
You know, it's really going to be interesting to me to see how Rich approaches this. So going against Genji, you've got to watch for the deflect. Protected, by the way. ETC can give himself armor. Early pulse bombs pre-10 don't normally get kills on tanks. So will Rich be able to find an opportunity? Can he see when the bio kill switch has been used by Stukov, find an opportunity to soften somebody up? And when you look at Tassadar and Falstad, they're not necessarily prepping a kill for Tracer to go in and get that pulse bomb off onto somebody. I think cumulatively it's going to take a true 5-man team effort in order to see Rich really pop off on that back line.
And I can't help but feel like this first control point that's going to be spawning here. Both teams are getting the camps equal timing, nobody pulling ahead, but it's going to really set the tone for this game. Just because both teams have a pretty successful team fight oriented composition. The Mouthail for the side soak though up on top is definitely a setback here for Tempest over this shrine if they struggle whatsoever. Just because that rotation should be a little bit slower compared to the Falstad. But right now it's just going to be Tassadar matching the Mouthail pressure. Genji going in for a little bit. Not heading Swift Strike. Power Slide out. Iron Skin Force. Go ahead and drop the turret here for KSV. The Pulse Bomb is used and Sign drops to 50%.
Yeah, he drops and then instantly you see the heal going out. Bio Kill Switch is used. And, you know, particular interesting thing that I think we learned from the Western Clash, watching Shad in particular on that Stukov. We see Dami under assault. Nice dodge there by Rich. Zero ping definitely makes that a little bit easier, but that's still by no means an easy task. But the slide onto Johanna that they got earlier, if you can get the lurking arm to follow up on that, Johanna not having the iron skin, that could have been a dead Johanna had they been a little bit more coordinated.
I said it a lot at the Western Clash that Stukov is such an effective initiator. Power Slide does land on the Rich this time. There's the lurking arm. Condemn is going to get the interrupt. Pulse Bomb goes down. Dami, he's going to deflect it right back. Reset looks to join in here. Pressure out good and friend. Sign looking for that Power Slide. Going to go through the choke, but it's not off cooldown yet. There it goes on to Tiss. Iron Skin dropped. Dami goes in for the reset. Not going to have it here. KSV dropping the heels with thanks to Sake. Nice concussive mind reset. Forced to use that barrel roll.
Oh, he couldn't have mashed that E key any faster. He's like, oh, this is not where I want to be. There's another pulse bomb used there on the sign. Again, pre-10, they're not necessarily going to confirm as many kills as you would like. You don't get that percentage-based damage. And on the front line with that armor, it's not that easy.
Oh, that's a lot of damage there for over the wall. Reset actually knowing that back was going to happen there. With the pressure being applied by KSV, they find themselves at least percentage here, right, over the first control point. I was going to say that because that skirmish was happening for so very long, I was concerned now post-7, we talked about the Falstad having wave clear coming online, would KSV decide to go with more of a stall tactic, right? The threatening 4-man, keep the Falstad off, look for the side soak and abuse that now the fact that he has the wave clear. But they're able to, you know, flex up here and still even bring the fight this early on. And I can't help but feel like that's a pretty concerning sign for Tempest because that is still going to be an option as the game furthers and we find ourselves more control points.
First control point controlled here, of course, by KSV Black, sending it in. Lockdown under assault there by Rich, still receiving those Tassadar shields, looking for that opportunity, finding a way to get a kill. Unable to do so thus far. Zion starting to aggress forward. Nice nature's cure there by Socket.
Reset, though, goes over on the conveyor belt, finds himself a Dami. Got to get the trade very good for Dami as that forces the tap from the false ad down below. Rich, though, going in, getting a bit of pressure. Response, fighting back. It's going to fall low. Not going to use the recall yet. Look at that damage. Reset goes and gets a lot. He ends up getting the first kill, but it costs him his life as Dami goes in with that swift strike.
Yeah, you could see the coordination there. Rich dodging again. Sign now, however, does not have that escape. So Rich trying to get in there as well as Tist. Moving forward, aggressing forward, 99%. We are in overtime, and I don't think Tempest is going to be able to contest this much.
Oh!
A pulse bomb used! Rich baited that out and gets that second kill of that fight, and that is style right there.
Rich is looking good on the Tracer. We wondered if we would see that, you know, throwback to the comfort of here's Kyoji going to be bringing back out the Tracer, but the fact that we have Rich on it, he is very much putting up a solid case for it because Kyoji, you know, especially early in his career, I criticize his hero pool a lot of times saying that he's kind of, you know, the walking Falset, Tracer, Tacit, or Abathur. That is his hero pool. But, I mean, and you to the fact that we can see Rich move over to that and just be equally as impressive on it, and it shows why they have the trust to transition him here towards that range role. And now they find themselves not only this protector, a full level advantage here, heroics as well. It's how much can they get, you know, with this time, with this protector.
Yeah.
Double front wall rotation is going to be nice to be able to open this up, really accenting the false set. He's going to be a lot more problematic over those next control points.
Yeah, this right here is basically the way that you see teams approaching this now. The protector is so strong after the changes that you go through, you get the mid-fort wall. That gives you that experience to snowball towards 10. The threat of 10 is too much for the enemy team. Then you move directly to the top lane. You take the wall and the well minimum to set yourself up for the next control point, controlling that top lane, because that's where the next control point will be. Very good macro awareness, simple, and very effective.
Yeah, very much so. There was an interesting transition from Reset for a moment there. Nice knockback there on the mines. Could have sent Rich into a recall. With the flight attempt up towards top, didn't actually show himself through middle, and I thought they might try to get the gank on the mid, but KSV's going to slow the pace here, not get too aggressive. And oftentimes it does feel like on a map like Volskaya, at least from what we felt at the Western Clash, it is kind of a slower tone until you get the protector, and then because that protector is so heavily empowered and so effective, not only at sieging, but the threat it provides in the team fights, it is kind of a not so macro focus. It's just going to be wait for the objective, try and find a way to get a fight. Obviously, if you can get that experience elsewhere to eke over your opponents, you will look to do so, but more often than not, it's just all about that fight. Turns out J-House might broke.
Speaking of all about that fight, I'm actually curious. Because Stukov is holding his heroic, and he's either going to go flailing swiper or give him the big old stiff arm, and I'm trying to think what he's considering in this, but hold on a second.
Quiet.
As the Twilight Dream hit, as well as the pulse bomb onto Genji, that's going to be another kill there for Rich.
That was very well done with the Twilight Dream timing. It was just a fraction of a second away before the silence would go down. You see the deflect, and that is going to be Dami keeping himself up. KSV here, not showing any reserve, you know, would get threat onto the Genji. That's now twice in a row that they are willing to really pressure out Dami. And something's got to be done about that as these team fights kind of progress in that KSV is getting this lead. We do see, though, as the skirmish unfolded, it was going to be the massive shove over the flailing swipe opportunity. And I can't help but feel like I agree with this. I like the fact that they have that, the double threat. Blessed Shield's going to come here into mid. Massive shoves used. Hyde going to keep himself up for now, but Rich is not done. He eats a power slide. Nature's Cure comes in. Pulse Bomb dropped, but the passive use from Hyde keeps him alive.
Yeah, the bio kill switch is there. Now all of a sudden we've got Tormented Souls as well as the Dragon Blade stage dive coming in. However, they've turned it on to Mouthel. Dami is trying to be saved. He is safe as Sign comes in with a power slide. Tracer goes down, but Sign will pay with his life to save his teammates.
So much pressure on the map at this point too, because the camp is threatening towards top that entire time. The fact that KSV is just diving and pressuring, staggering the deaths here of Tempest. Tempest needs to find a way to hit the brakes.
No. This is going to be a fun one.
Oh, how long is this going to take, actually, Junkrat? Well, I guess it's not that long.
He doesn't have 13.
Yeah, I moved right in there to the rest of the members of KSV. That's another kill. It will be timed almost dead even with the control point, only about a 10-second rotational advantage for KSV Black in that 5 versus 4.
Now, this is a part that's scary for me. Tempest is going to have to try and do something different at this point because you're going to have Reset. He's going to be soaking these lanes. 16 is going to be close. And if this does go, if you're Black, you can sit there and say, look, we're going to give this up. You can get the first part of the channel because we're just going to soak 16, then we'll move forward. That's kind of the timing of Volskaya. And I think that's a macro play that KSV, if they need it, can take advantage of.
attempt at getting a little bit of pressure here onto Rich as he's very far out. There goes the deflect. Expect him to capitalize on that whenever you see that use. No pulse bomb used quite yet, but look at that zoning. It's so much threat out here, and it's not like ETC is going to be effective into that false head two versus, or excuse me, side soaking kind of escapade, if you will. Percentage accumulated KSV. This with a 16 talent here and a punisher, I mean, they likely can find themselves that top key to hear J-Hal.
That is a very scary prospect at this point because they'll pick this up so quickly. Tempest will not be able to obtain 16 in the meantime, although they've got their eyes on reset. Calculated by a reset.
You know, you say that.
Do you think that's a...
Dami's going
yeah,
for this.
Yeah, he's afraid of Genji.
Oh, he actually went for the cyber agility over the wall, but he wasn't willing to commit. Maybe if he went with the conveyor belt and possibly get within the range.
Well, reset, he's like, look, I'm going to hurt... Wait a minute. Hold on. I'm going against somebody who's next level. I'm not going to risk it. Now, as you had foretold, they're moving here towards the top lane and getting a top keep with a global of Falstad and moving in knowing the next control point is bottom. This is a major power play if they're able to get this.
It should be noted with that gank on bottom, though. Dami displayed himself on bottom about 5 seconds before the stage dive was committed. Pulse Bomb is going to be used on the lockdown, drop out the passive, and there is the Protector to get that laser out. A kill blown up here with a man down. Well, honestly, they probably could have done it without a man down, but this is definitely the keep here. KSV Rich putting on a clinic on that Tracer, zoning. It looks like 1v5 a majority of this game, but Dragonblade used Twilight Dream, shuts it down. There is a kill again for Rich. Pulse Bomb onto Sign, locks down a third, and now look at that flight in. There is the Gus. Good night, good. Four members out. This is now game. KSV Black just dominant.
Just like that, I mean, they opened it up. The threat of the Protector, getting that first kill on a Junkrat, that was already like, wait a minute, I think we're getting there. And they got that next kill and the next kill, keeping Rich alive. Sake has done such an amazing job on Malfurion in this game, getting that heal, that clutch heal to keep Rich alive. Had Rich gone down, that would have been a different story, but the Protector stayed alive, and the core did not. KSV coming out hot in game one.
Just want to say, I am sorry I ever doubted you, KSV Black, because if there is anything that could be done to put, you know, instill faith, that game on Volskaya with that kind of dominance against Tempest, who again was, you know, undefeated in a match score when looking at the Korean region. I mean, what just happened?
I'm going to say map choice, strictly because looking at, we addressed it, the hero pool of Tempest is not that large. And then we looked at some of their hero pools. Look, they are world-class players, and there is something to be said about comfort heroes on most battlegrounds. This is a battleground that those comfort heroes don't necessarily work, and they had to change it up a little bit. I don't think they were as prepared as KSV was, but again, it was KSV's map choice, and I think that they had a strategy they were able to execute.
I think the big learning thing for me was this is the first pro match I've seen of Korean players, obviously on both sides, since the last time Tempest played, and it was after the Protector changes. And that thing basically hits hard. I mean, we saw them just simply commit to winning both of those fights.
Yeah.
When they won the fights, they controlled the map. Then they took every camp. They had turret advantages, for example, the healing pulse. All these, they had basically every tool you could have on the map at all times. Won two fights and won the game off of that. And the Protector was killing people. I mean, it wasn't like the kill feed comes up and says Johanna kills Junkrat, but it doesn't mean, you know, Johanna killed Junkrat. It means that Protector will kill you.
Yeah,
it's such a difficult thing to deal with. I feel like the comp of KSV Black just kind of threw macro out the window too. They weren't really split pushing with Falstad. Almost felt like that was a backup plan that they just didn't need. And to be honest, I was pretty surprised at how dominant of a game this was.
I feel like a lot of it comes down to just Rich was ready to dominate over that middle fight. Like, he got a lot of outplay when it came to the resource trade-off and a lot of the positioning questions.